After Jesus had ascended into heaven, his first followers began to spread the news about what Jesus had said and done. The Jewish religious leaders, who did not believe that Jesus was the Messiah, grew very angry and persecuted them. Jesus' followers were captured and tortured, and some were even killed. Seeking safety, they scattered all over the region. As they did, they continued to share about Jesus wherever they went. One of these followers was named Philip, who was living in a region called Samaria, sharing about Jesus and performing miracles. One day, an angel of God told Philip to leave where he was and travel south down a rugged road in the wilderness. Along Philip's journey, he encountered a man from the country of Ethiopia. The man was a eunuch, someone who was entrusted to care for the queen of Ethiopia. This eunuch was in charge of the entire treasury of the queen. He had been in Jerusalem to worship, and on his way home was sitting in his chariot, reading the writings of the prophet Isaiah. God's spirit spoke to Philip, "Go to that chariot and stay near it." Philip ran up to the chariot and heard the man reading Isaiah. "Do you understand what you are reading?" Philip asked the eunuch. "How can I?" the man replied. "Unless someone explains it to me." So the man invited Philip to come up into the chariot and sit with him. The eunuch was reading a part of the book of Isaiah, which said, "He was led like a sheep to slaughter, and as a lamb before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from the earth." The eunuch asked Philip, "Who is the prophet talking about, himself or someone else?" Then Philip began with that very passage from the book of Isaiah and told the eunuch the good news about Jesus. As they continued traveling the wilderness road, they came upon some water. "Look," the eunuch said, "here is water. What can stand in the way of me being baptized?" He gave orders to stop the chariot, and both he and Philip went down to the water. There, Philip baptized the Ethiopian eunuch. When the eunuch came up out of the water, God's spirit suddenly took Philip away, and the eunuch never saw him again. The eunuch returned home to Ethiopia, rejoicing over what had happened.
The truth of that song is what we're going to be engaged in during the message today, is both the need that you and I have recognized at some point in our life that led us to Christ and what he did for us on the cross. And then once we have become the recipients of that kind of relationship, are you and I willing to be engaged in the process of leading others to that same incredible gift that we have now received? So thank you. What a tone to set for today. Let me lighten your mood just a little bit, though. I did a memorial service yesterday. You're saying that's going to lighten the mood? Yeah. Terrific lady and a rather interesting family. This lady had 6 kids, 4 daughters, 2 sons. Okay, that's not all that, you know, the women outnumbered the men, but it's still not bad, 2-1, all right? 16 grandchildren, 14 grandchildren, 11 granddaughters, 3 grandsons, 23 great-grandchildren, 21 great-granddaughters, 2 great-grandsons. Lots of hormones in that house, all right, as we celebrated grandma and great-grandma and mom, but she thought she had a great sense of humor. This is according to the grandkids and the great-grandkids. Grandma and great-grandma had, in her mind, a great sense of humor, and here was her favorite joke. Do you know where the Easter Bunny took his family for brunch on Easter Sunday? IHOP! Now, don't you feel better already this morning? Aren't you glad you got here? Welcome to New Hope Church. It is great to have you here today on a foggy day schedule, all right? 8 o'clock service was a little light, okay? And some of you all are regular 8 o'clock folks. And so thank you for still coming, all right? We're very grateful for that. But glad you're here today. If you are visiting New Hope, you honor us. We don't take the privilege of your presence lightly. We are so grateful for you joining us. And we hope that you will leave with a sense of inspiration that you didn't arrive with. We trust you will leave with something that was beneficial and helpful for you. So thank you for joining us. I am a little bit nosy, so I'd love to know that you were here today. There's a visitor card in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to fill it out. We make a promise around here. We will not beat on your door. We will not bother you on the phone. But this next week, we will send you some information in the mail that tells you about the church. Answer, we hope, a lot of your questions about kids' ministries and children's ministries and men and women, small groups, service times. All that we'll send to you. So if you would do that, we would love it very much. Those same cards are for regular folks in our church as well who attend on a regular basis. I said that kind of poorly, I think, because most of our folks here aren't regular, all right? You know, I mean, I don't know if they're regular or not. They just attend. Now I'm digging a deeper hole for me. So anyway, those cards are for everybody else who, if you have prayer requests or announcements or appointment you want to make with the staff, use those cards. Drop them in the offering bag when they come by, and if it gets by too soon, hand it to one of our ushers at the door as you leave, all right? We'd love to get that information to you. Let me highlight a few announcements and then some prayer requests, and we will get engaged in our worship. Check the bulletin. There is a women's trip coming up, all right? I believe it's a spiritual adventure to deepen your faith in God at Gilroy. I didn't know Gilroy could do that to a group of women, but anyway, read the bulletin, check it out, and next week tickets will be available for that trip out in the pavilion, all right? Next Sunday night, church-wide meeting. Next Sunday night, 6 p.m., right here in the sanctuary. We hope you'll come. We'll be distributing the end-of-the-year financial statement for 2014. We have some elder board recommendations for terms of service to share with you and for your approval. And we also have something we do not do very often. In fact, it has been, I believe it's been 12 years since the last time we did this. So it doesn't happen often. We have a pastoral position to recommend to you and a hire, all right? We have been looking for about 2 years for a person who could serve New Hope Church and address the needs of young adults, particularly emphasizing young married couples and young families, 25 to 39. We realize you can't be hard and fast on those parameters. We have some young marriage in our church, younger than 25. And then we have a few couples where one of them would fall in that 30 range and the husbands fall in the much older range, but we would let them be included in that. Not pointing out anybody specifically, Addis's, but anyway, we have that. We have that here, and so anyway, we have been through a process of about 4 interviews with a gentleman and his family. They've been attending our church for the last couple of months, and so we can't wait to make that presentation to you. His name is Nick Delgado. You'll probably see him in the next service, and we would love to have you out next Sunday night so that you all can grill him and then hopefully approve him, all right, as we attempt to take this next important step in our church family. Hey, 13 days from today, 8 of us from New Hope will be on our way to the Ivory Coast of Africa. So please be in prayer for us as we are engaged in that process, and we'll have some more specific things to share with you next Sunday. Several families I want you to continue to pray for God's care and comfort in their lives, for the Yoakum family, for the Myers family, the Hill and Green families, Glenn Mattson's brothers, Nita Throwbridge service I was talking about yesterday, Elaine from our congregation, her mom passed away week before last, 2 pending services, though the deaths occurred last year. 1 service is next Saturday for Naomi Millar from our church, and then Aaron Stonehouse will be in February. Continue to pray for those recovering from surgeries, and Marianne is home from the hospital in rehab now. Continue to pray for her. Wanda Wood is home from her surgery this week. Continue to pray for Myrna, Rich's mom, and Mikey as she is battling the infection in her knee. So just several folks to give you some updates on. We have a surgery pending this week for Helen, the end of the week, and so that's going to be at Kaiser, so please be in prayer. So just a few of the updates that we wanted to share with you. This will be your last Sunday to walk out of here, go through those doors, hang a short right,
and put your name on the wall of truth. All right? This is, if you're visiting for the very first time, this is our second wall of truth. We're in a series called Believe. What are the 10 key truths we build our life on? What are the 10 key practices hinged to those 10 key truths? When you believe something, you should practice what you believe. And when we put our practice and our belief and we align them together, God is able to produce in us what we will start looking at next Sunday, the last 10 key subjects, and that is the 10 virtues of the life of Christ that will be evident in us. And so this is the second wall of truth. If you believe those 10 key practices, go put your name on the wall, all right? So thank you so very, very much for doing that. We do have a couple of young ladies visiting us today, and they're going to tell me next time that they're coming, and you're going to be in for a treat because these two girls can sing, all right? I'm not pointing them out. I'm not embarrassing, though they're turning red sitting on the pew right where they are at the moment, but I'll be looking forward to that. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, if they would, please, at the moment, and wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. Let's pray. Our Father, though it is a foggy day schedule outside, the sun is still shining brightly. Reminds me there are times in life that your sun is shining brightly, but we create some fog of our own that stops the brilliance of the light of your sun to be seen in us because of interference that we have created in our own world. But Father, your sun still shines. And so our prayer today is that Father, just as you parted the Red Sea so Israelites could walk on dry ground, I pray that you will part the fog today so that the brilliance of your life can be seen in and through us this day. Thank you, Father, that you are big enough for the task that any of us face in life. Whatever circumstances, troubles, pains, or problems that folks have come here with today, I pray that this will be a day in which there'll be a surrender of those things to you, a recognition that we can't handle and or solve these issues out of our own resources, and we are prepared to trust and in trusting find rest in these situations because we surrender them to you. Father, my prayer today is as we talk about personal faith, that if there is a man or a woman or a young person sitting in a pew today, they might not even know why they're here. They might have not even come willfully today. But I trust they will discover what it means to have a personal relationship with you. Not to become religious, not to become a member of a church, but what it means to know that you as God love them and want to live within them. And I pray some important decisions will be made today. Father, for the privilege of giving and sharing, thank you for the opportunity that is ours to do so. Thank you for the way in which you meet our needs and the needs of your kingdom work in this world. We surrender those to you in the incredible name of Christ.
Evangelism is not for the weak, all right? I should know. I wrote a whole book about it, self-published. Most Christians, they are just good for bake sales and potluck dinners. But I'm telling you this right now, it takes a lot of moxie to grab a non-believer by the shirt collar and throw him in the front doors of a church and say, hey, try living out your heathen life in front of a holy God that way. It is like holy water on a vampire. That's divine intervention, my friend.
Repent, for the kingdom of the Lord is nigh. Come to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Well, sir, it sounds like you're really passionate about Jesus.
I am. And you should also be.
Okay.
Passionate about the Lord.
Sir, if there's...
You need to get sanctified or chicken fried. You need to get with the Lord or drive a Ford.
Sir, we...
Get right or get left.
I share my faith. Okay, that's a lie. People don't even know I'm a Christian. I want to. Again, another lie. I hardly shower, much less have the will to do anything else. Okay. Now, if there was pizza and ice cream every time there was faith sharing, I'd do it. That's a lie. I'm lactose intolerant. Again, another lie. I'm just too cheap to buy dairy. Bottom line, sharing my faith makes me sweaty. Tip number 95, use big church words like transubstantiation. Heathens get confused easily, and the more confused they are, the more ashamed they are. The more ashamed they are, the more apt they are to make a decision for Jesus Christ.
I believe it's a responsibility, no. The privilege, no. The glorious privilege of every believer to share their faith with others. That's why I share my faith with everyone I come in contact with.
Everyone, really?
Yeah, everyone.
How do you do that?
Check out my shirt. Can't read it? Try this glove. Not working for you? How about this bracelet? No comprendo? Vistazo a estos. Driving behind me? Read my bumper sticker. Says, it's okay if you follow close. I'm going to heaven. Oh, you're my waiter or waitress? I got a tip for you. Surprise! It's the gospel. I mean, what do you want, money or eternity? I also use these tracks.
So, what about talking to people about your faith?
I don't really like people, but I love Jesus. Scripture mint?
Hi, my name is George.
And I'm Jorge, and together we're George and Jorge.
Right, right. What we like to do is to take secular songs and reprogram them.
Yes, the purpose is for evangelism. We like to take songs to the unbelieving world and make it believable.
Right, right. Let us give you a sample right now.
You tick. What is it? You're headed to H-E double hockey sticks.
Hey, lost sinner, why don't you just give it all up to Jesus?
Tonight, pray for your soul today, for your soul today. Just pray.
I was a freshman in college the first time I invited someone to church.
My best buddy called me. I was working at a grocery store. I was in the back cutting carrots, and my buddy called me.
And I just said, hey, do you want to go to church with me tonight? And I remember his words. He said,
sure, I got nothing better to do. And I went to church with him. And you know, I went there because they were serving pizza that night. I don't remember what was said. I don't remember what was sung.
During the services, I remember praying for him and just asking God to please reach out and touch his heart or do something because I knew he needed Jesus. And then God answered my prayers.
That night changed my life, September 17th, 1987. It changed my life because I realized I needed a Savior.
Over the last 3 weeks, as we are wrapping up this second portion of our Believe series, looking at the 10 key practices, over the last 3 weeks, we have looked at time. Corey preached to you on that subject, making good use of our time. Last week, we looked at the tithe, all right, using your resources for kingdom work. And today, we're going to wrap up the last of the 10 key practices. And what we're going to talk about today is testimony, sharing our faith. And I want to approach this last of these 10 key practices from two perspectives this morning. Number one, I want to take a few minutes and hopefully personally illustrate what it's like to share my own faith. And maybe actually in these first 5 or 6 minutes, one of you might make a decision to discover faith for yourself. That would certainly be the greatest hope that I could have. And after we've done that, I want to follow up then for several minutes by challenging all of us who already have faith in Jesus Christ. I want to challenge all of us to become intentional about sharing our own faith. People often say faith is a very private and personal matter. And yes, faith is a private and personal decision that each one of us should make. But I don't think the one who we have a relationship with is intended to be kept a secret. And I don't think it is the responsibility of just the professional staff to be engaged in sharing our faith. It's called testimony. So allow me for the first few minutes this morning to share my faith in Jesus Christ's story. Let me prepare you. It's boring. At various moments in my life, I have wished I was a professional athlete so I could tell you about my success that got me into the Hall of Fame and how that led me to faith in Jesus Christ. I wished I could tell you that, I spent years in prison and there found Jesus Christ. I've spent some hours in prison, but they always let me out. And I'm not sure what's up with that when they won't even want to keep you in prison, all right? There's something very discouraging about that. I remember on one occasion I was traveling in a van with Buf Carriker, the former pastor at Northwest Church. And, you know, Buf was bigger than life, and there were nine of us, either pastors or ministry leaders in the city of Fresno and Clovis. We went to a San Francisco Giants game the first year the new stadium was opened. And on the way home, it's 10:30 at night, and so Buf from the driver's seat yells back, "Hey, everybody, I want you to share your testimony." Well, I was in the very back of the van. Though I was the first one there, a couple of guys thought it would be funny to see if I could convince Buf to let me drive the van, because Buf drove like a maniac. But he was also a control freak. So they encouraged me just to sit in the front seat of the van. And so, in the driver's seat, when Buf came out, maybe he would just get in. He didn't. When he saw me in the driver's seat, he banished me to the back row of the van. So on the way home, I'm sitting in my seat, and everybody else shares. I am the very last one. And all of them had very interesting stories of how eventually they came to faith. And so it becomes my opportunity to share, and I just said, "Guys, I thank you for all your testimonies, and I just want to tell you how grateful I am for God, who saved me from drug and alcohol abuse, and I am so grateful, that he redeemed me out of sexual addiction and unholy practices." And I put together about a 2-minute list of rather disgusting things, and Buf from the front said, "Man, Roland, I didn't know you did all that." And I said, "Guys, I didn't do any of that. God saved me when I was 5, and he saved me from doing any of those things." I just didn't want to be boring. So I'm preparing you now, all right? Here's my story of faith in Jesus Christ. I am a believer personally in Jesus Christ. I'm primarily a believer because of the influence of my family from the day I was born. I recognized very early in my life that I was not perfect, but God loved me. The Bible bluntly calls me a sinner, but Jesus Christ loved me so much, he did what was necessary so that my imperfection, my sinfulness, would not lead to my destruction. As a 5-year-old boy, my faith was very simple. Jesus loved me, this I know, for the Bible told me so. Jesus wanted a relationship with me. Jesus wanted me to go to heaven someday, and I did not want to go to hell. So on the third Thursday of June in 1960, when an Oklahoma preacher by the name of Lynn Wood was preaching at Hume Lake Christian Campgrounds, I walked an aisle down a wooden floor to a wooden altar, and I invited Jesus Christ to be my Savior. At 10 years of age, I faced the very first tragedy of my life, the death of my grandfather. Oh, how I loved him, and oh, how he loved God. I witnessed firsthand from my family and friends how there is hope and despair at a moment like that, how he provides comfort when our hearts are filled with sorrow, how there can be joy in the middle of tragedy. Months after my grandfather died, it was July, in fact, 6 months later, on vacation in Oklahoma with my family, in a living room of some friends of my grandfather, I heard God speak to me. It was not a voice. I'm Baptist. It was louder than a voice. It was not through my ears, but it was in my soul. I knew God's direction for my life. That is scary for a 10-year-old. I kept silent. Who's going to believe me? At 15, I struggled with this call that God had placed on my life. It was now time for me to act on what I had known for half a decade, but I'm 15. I'm a teenager. And as a pastor's son, I knew the responsibility that comes with publicly acknowledging God has a call on your life. I wavered. But God used a very good friend to nudge me in the right direction. So it was on February 8th, 1970, I accepted and announced the call to preach the gospel. And 2 weeks later, on February the 22nd, I preached my first sermon. Baptists don't allow you to wait very long to get started. At 27, I had my first and I think my only major crisis of faith. Being betrayed by my best friend and barely surviving a coup in the church that my dad had started, I was fit to quit with faith. I was vulnerable to the rejection of my faith because of hurtful actions of others. I was allowing my personal relationship with Jesus to be influenced by the way a church and individuals treated me. I doubted God's truth. I was now doubting God's call. I even questioned whether God existed. Understand, I'm an ordained preacher, a Bible college graduate, an associate pastor, and I'm struggling with the reality of God. But when we are faithless, God is very, very faithful. Just months before my world collapsed, I had studied for the first time a little book entitled The Saving Life of Christ by Major Ian Thomas. The thrust of this little book is the all-sufficiency of Jesus Christ because Christ comes to live within us. The centrality of Jesus and the reality that biblical faith is about a personal relationship with Jesus rather than involvement in religion or church life, it challenged my thinking like never before. And God would use the principles out of that little book as a safety net for my present dilemma and discouragement. In my hurt and frustration, I went back to the Bible to discover if I could believe the truths that were in this book for the rest of my life. I didn't go to the Bible to learn this time how to be a good pastor or a popular preacher. But I went to the book this time to learn how to be in and with Christ all that He promised I could be. As a 5-year-old, I had learned about Christ so that I could live with Jesus after I died. But now, I was about to discover what it meant to have the indwelling presence of Christ in me every moment of every day. Late one evening, after rereading a chapter in that little book called The Saving Life of Christ and thinking about the implications of Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, not I, but Christ lives in me, and the life I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God who died and who gave Himself to me. I woke up a few hours later. It's the middle of the night. And for the second time in my life, I heard that still, soft voice of God shout to my soul. This is what I've been waiting for, Tim! I've been waiting for you to quit. When you quit trying to be all I've gifted you to be, I can now be in business. I can do for you what you can never ever do for yourself. From that day to this, I have never wavered in my confidence in Christ. I have never doubted that God is. I have never wanted to live life on my own without dependence upon Him. I have failed. I have struggled. I have made some poor decisions. I have sinned. I have been betrayed again. I have been hurt again. I have experienced troubles. But through it all, I have never once believed that Jesus didn't love me. That His strength wasn't sufficient for what I was facing. That His hope would not overcome my despair. I have found comfort and joy and peace and hope and passion in this promise of Jesus when He said, I will never leave you. And I will never forsake you. As a child, Jesus found me. As an adult, I found God. I've never been the same. I am madly in love with my Savior, and I would like for you to be too. Is there any reason why you could not ask Jesus Christ into your life right now? That's my story. I don't know what brought you here today. Maybe you came to hear the difference that Jesus Christ can make in your life. The sermon's not over, but you don't have to wait till the end of the sermon to invite Jesus to come live in you. A simple prayer that goes like this. Heavenly Father, I confess I need a Savior. Would you come live in my life and save me? Come into my life and change me? I want to spend eternity with you. Thank you for dying on a cross for me. Thank you for being raised from the dead for me. Thank you for the new life that you will bring to me. I don't understand it all, but I'm ready. In Jesus' name, amen. There could be one or two of you who just now invited Christ in your life. He was listening. And what I've just done in these last 5.5 minutes is exactly what you can do with your story, with your best friend, with your son, with your daughter, with a coworker. The second thing I wanted to do on this was I want to challenge all of you who have faith. For those of you who are already here, you've prayed some kind of prayer very similar to that already. I want to challenge all of you who have faith to intentionally share your faith. And I want to see if I can illustrate encouragement in this area with a couple of fables, okay? And imagine this following scenario. You are walking down a mall. Maybe you're in Gilroy, okay? And you're walking down the mall and you're window shopping. And you look inside a window and something inside that store catches your eye. And once inside, you notice you're having some rather unusual feelings. And you're thinking, something about this place is different than other ones I've been in before. You're not quite sure if you like it or not, but you're interested. Something prompts you to continue to explore what's there. The staff who are inside, they're very friendly, engaging, and they're readily available without being pushy. You notice, though, that things you're looking at, none of them have price tags on them. And so you ask for a little assistance. And one of the staff comes over and says, there's no charge for that. It's free. And you're like, well, what about that? Well, no, it's yours. Take it. Your response creates surprise and suspicion in this person. How can you be so generous with your stuff? And their answer surprises you even more. And they say to you, we're not generous. We're only sharing with you what was given to us when we walked in just like you did. Curiosity now has the best of you. And you say, guys, I don't understand this. And one of the staff says, let me see if I can explain it. We are not the one who is generous. It's the creator of this place. He's the one who gives freely of all of his stuff. Every one of us you see in here walked in here just like you. Curious, searching, wanting, skeptical, maybe desperate. Some of us came in here intentionally. Others of us just kind of stumbled in. A few of us were actually brought by a friend or a relative. We looked around just like you are. Then they did what we're about to do. We're going to introduce you to the one who is so gracious. You're now asked to turn around and standing right behind you, like he had been there the entire time, is the founder of this enterprise. Introductions are made from the staff to the owner, and you were invited into one of the most comfortable rooms you've ever been in. You're offered refreshments, an opportunity to visit with the one who gives so much away. After just a couple of minutes in his presence, you feel like this guy has known you all of your life. You have no secrets. You sense that you ought to be embarrassed, but his acceptance is so overwhelming, you just continue to enjoy. The time with him is a mixture of emotions. It's from amazing to weird. It's from comfortable to a little convicting. It's scary, but yet it's hopeful. As the conversation is winding down, the owner asks you a couple of very direct, pointed questions. Would you like to be part of my team? Would you like to receive everything you see in the store? Would you like not only to have what you can see, but would you like to receive daily deposits into your bank account that will meet the need for everything that you face in life? You can't say fast enough, "Of course I would, but what's the catch?" And he says, "No catch. There's just an admission and a choice. You must admit that you cannot provide for yourself as well as I can provide for you. And you must choose to let me adopt you as a member of my family." You think about it for a few seconds and then you ask, let me see if I get this straight. I admit that I'm not capable of controlling my life as you are. Then you will adopt me into your family and you will give me everything I need to live until I die, right? Wrong! I knew it! No, wait a minute. You're wrong because I did not say that these benefits would end at your death. In fact, when you were adopted into my family, one of the benefits is that death becomes a doorway to an even greater life and more abundance than you could ever hope or imagine. I will give you treasures every day on earth, and I will deposit treasures for your enjoyment forever. And one more thing. What? Not only is this offer good for you, but once you receive the offer, you can go make this same offer to anybody that you know, love, and care about. If that kind of scenario happened to you, what would you do? Would you jump at the proposal? Would you postpone? Would you reject? Would you text, tweet, or Facebook? Can anybody tell me? Is this for real? If you didn't accept it, what would be your reasons for rejecting it, for postponing it? And if you did accept his offer, to whom and how often would you be willing to share it? Let me pitch one more fable at you, this one much, much shorter. What if a guy walked up to your front door and knocked? You answer the door and say, "Didn't you see that no solicitation sign?" The stranger replies, I'm not here to solicit. I'm here to give away. I'm prepared to give you all of my time and all of my treasures, which I have an unending supply of both, if you will allow me to live in your home. All that I have is yours if you let me hang out with you. I will give you $5,000 a day automatically put in your bank account if you'll just let me call this home. Not only am I willing to make this offer to you, but I will make the same promise to any of your friends and family that you share it with. And I do not work for Amway. What would you do with that kind of offer? Guys, those seem to be like silly stories. But if those were real, wouldn't we jump at both of them? And wouldn't we go as fast as we could and tell our kids and our spouse and our neighbors, and we would even tell people we don't like very well because it's such an incredible offer. And yet, when you and I enter into a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, and we are given a holiness we don't deserve, and we are given an eternity that we could not earn, we often tell no one. Why? Why? If you just got engaged, do you keep that a secret? Ladies, what do you do as soon as you get the ring on your finger? What do you do? You don't even wait for somebody to say, "Hi, how are you?" You just go. And yet Jesus has proposed marriage to every single one of us. When Jesus died on a cross and rose again from the dead, the scripture says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him would not perish, but have everlasting life." Through his works and through his miracles, Jesus has proposed marriage to every one of you. He wants a relationship with you. And if you've invited him into your life, how come you're not doing it? I thought about that long and hard this week. And I think one of the primary reasons we are so resistant to share our testimony is because we know how communication can be so confusing sometimes. We know how sometimes we can be so misunderstood. It is one of the reasons I really don't like texting for anything more than time, place, and date. I cannot tell you how often as a pastor there have been married couples or friends in my office with problems that originated with a misunderstanding through a text. Because communication is confusing and it can be hurtful. And I think Satan promotes this concept so you and I will not share our faith. Let me illustrate how confusing simple communication can sometimes be. A woman from Kentucky tells the following story. After directory assistance gave me my boyfriend's new telephone number, I dialed him, and another woman answered his phone. "Is Mike there?" I asked. "He's in the shower," she responded. "Well, please tell him his girlfriend called." When Mike didn't call her back for about an hour, she dialed again. This time, the man answered. "This is Mike." "You're not my boyfriend." "I know," he replied. "That's what I've been telling my wife for the last hour." See, communication can get a little confusing sometimes. And Paul wanted to avoid this kind of confusion and situation, so he pointedly asked for prayer as he personally, from his own life, shared the good news of a relationship with Jesus Christ. In your Believe Bibles, on the opening page of chapter 20, you will find the key verse for today's thoughts, Ephesians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. And here is what Paul said. Paul said, "Pray also for me, that whenever I speak, words may be given me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should." Let's break down this verse. Let's take about 1 minute. All right, let's break this verse down, though, on this subject. Paul is saying there are some things that I recognize. Paul said, first of all, I recognize I have a need, so please pray for me. And you and I should recognize that each of us, as Christians in God's family, as part of His staff, that we have a need and we want others to pray for us so that we will accomplish the privilege of being an ambassador for God's kingdom. So he recognized the need. Pray for me. Number two, he prayed for recognition of opportunities. Notice the word whenever. Paul said, so whenever I have an opportunity to speak, pray so that I will recognize the whenever moments. Have you ever had a whenever moment and after it was over you said, "Oh, that was a perfect opportunity," and you missed it? So after you missed it, did you begin to pray so that God would help you recognize the next one so you wouldn't miss it? Paul then does a third thing. He recognizes he needs provisions. Words may be given. Paul was a well-educated, well-trained, experienced communicator. But Paul realized in sharing the testimony of faith in Jesus Christ, his own ability was not adequate. So he said, not only pray that I will recognize the opportunity, but pray that I will receive the words given to me by God. He then recognizes the responsibility and the privilege of being an ambassador. He uses this title. He says, "I am an ambassador." In a few minutes, we'll look a little more in depth at that. And then he says, pray. Notice he opens this verse with prayer. He ends the second verse. He says, "Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should." There's an indication that Paul was fearful. And so he asked for prayer that his fearfulness would be converted to fearlessness. He prayed for courage. For a vast majority of Christians, particularly in our politically correct culture, talking with a non-believer about a relationship with Christ seems to be a daunting and intimidating task. We can talk about weather. We can talk about fashion. We can talk about sports. We can talk about the current news. All that's good. We just can't talk about the president or Jesus. Okay? Both of those make us all very, very uncomfortable. Putting our message on the defense is a brilliant and clear strategy of Satan to keep people from hearing about salvation. But I am confident that quite likely you became a Christian because someone else was willing to risk and reach out to share the good news of Christ with you. It might not have been them sharing their own personal testimony. I had a guy 2 weeks ago and says, Pastor, I'm not quite ready for that, so let me tell you what I do. I ask my friends, I say something like this. I say, hey guys, my life's a little bit different right now, and I really can't explain it to you, but would you go with me to church on Sunday? My pastor will tell you all about it. That's a start. That's an open door. You don't have to just hand it over, though, to hired guns. You can actually engage in this your own self. But how do we end up doing that? Let's just do a quick poll right here. How many of you, your introduction to Jesus Christ was through a family member or a good friend? They may not be the one who led you to Christ, but the introduction to Christ came from a family member or friend. Raise your hand. Okay, quick, hold, leave them up. Look around. Just take a quick look around. All right? Very good. How many of you, maybe your introduction to Jesus was through a stranger, but somebody personally either invited you or shared with you, and that was your introduction to Jesus? Raise your hand. It was personal, okay? There's another 10 or 12. How many of you were just sitting around one day on your couch, riding in your car, sitting in the mountains, and you decided, I need God? I got two, right? Okay, I had one in the last service. That does happen. But notice the percentage. The vast majority of us come to this because of a friend or family member opening up their life, taking the risk and reaching. Paul writes this, how then can they call on the one whom they have not believed in? How can they believe in the one in whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone telling them? How can anyone preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful is the face of the one who shared the gospel with me. It's not what it said. How beautiful are the lips of the one who shared the gospel. Do you know what the scripture says? How beautiful are the feet. Possibly the ugliest part of the human body. God, some of y'all got ugly feet. I'll just be honest, okay? All right? I was gifted, okay? I was gifted. I have pretty feet, okay? The big toe is taller than the next toe, and it's slightly, you know, my son, Chad, he got ugly feet, man. He's just got ugly feet. They're hammer toes, all right? The second toe, it's tough to do with your hand. The second toe, all right, is longer than the first toe, okay? It just sticks out, and that's why he wears two sizes bigger because of the second toe. It's just ugly feet. But God, see, God uses this analogy. He uses this analogy for two reasons. One is, it is the gospel that makes the communicator beautiful. So he took the part that there could be not much confusion about. Also, it means you had to make a journey. Your feet is what helped deliver the message. It took you to the person to deliver it personally. How beautiful, are the feet of those who would be willing to bring the gospel to me. Precious. Key question, how do I share my faith with those who don't know? The key belief, the key truth that we looked at 10 weeks ago was eternity. There is a heaven, there is a hell, and Jesus will return to judge all people to establish His kingdom. And that is real. And if we believe that to be true and we know that our testimony can make a difference of a person going to hell or to heaven, why wouldn't we want to share that? The destination of people for all time is fully based on each one of us receiving forgiveness of our sins through Jesus Christ. He has provided the way of salvation, but people must embrace it individually for themselves. The gift is free. Regardless of what you have ever done in your past, no one, not a one of us, is unsavable. We as His disciples are here to let people know by how we live our lives, by the words that we speak, what we know to be true about Jesus. year in, year out, decade after decade, statistics show how people come to faith in Jesus. It is a clear majority, as we evidenced here. A person who cares enough to share the gospel story is how most of us come to know Christ. Relationships have always been and still are God's primary path for bringing people to His kingdom. God has one plan for saving the world, and it is you and me. I got to be honest, I don't think it's the best plan He could have come up with. But it is His plan. For more than 2,000 years, Christianity has been one generation away from extinction. Yet the plan keeps working. Faith moves forward. Do people still die without a relationship with Christ? Unfortunately, yes. But even still, our mission is simple. Tell the message to all that we can, because God has no grandchildren. My kids will not get into heaven because of me, and I will not enter heaven because of my mom and dad, as good as they are. Until I punched the ticket myself and said, Jesus, I accept what you have done for me, I could not enter the kingdom of heaven. Key idea, we share our faith with others to fulfill God's purpose. After we receive Christ, we may have different careers to earn a living, but we all have the same job description. 2 Corinthians 5:18 says this, all this, what's the all this? Our new life that's from God, who reconciled us to Himself through Christ, gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to Himself, not counting people's sins against them. He has committed us to this message of reconciliation. We, who's the we? All of us who have this new life. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, not just the apostles, not just the disciples, not just those called into ministry, all who have received new life. We are Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making His appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made Him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that in Him we might become the righteousness of God. What's the job description? To be an ambassador, every single one of us. What does an ambassador do? Takes the message out into the world. Across the street, around the globe, we tell our story, but we share His message. How does this happen? As though God makes His appeal through us. What did Paul pray for? Words given to him. Be reconciled to God. The debt we never could pay has been paid in full, and that is why the gospel is called good news. What's the key application of all this? What difference should this make in the way in which I live? First of all, let me remove a responsibility from off your shoulders. You and I are never responsible to save, but we are responsible to share so that God can save. Our goal is to bring revelation, not to broker a response. The end result is up to God and to the individual. We must learn to share our faith. When we do that, we plant seeds of truth. When we continue to share our story, we water and we irrigate those seeds with our lower story lives that's engaged with an upper story God, and then we watch and wait for this upper story God and those planted seeds to produce a harvest. While there are many methods and resources for talking to people about Christ, two simple approaches of sharing your faith, and one of them we've already illustrated to you this morning, and that is share your story. Share your story. I'm going to recommend a book for you to read if you want to get better at sharing your story. It's one written by Bill Hybels entitled Just Walk Across a Room. This would be a great one after we finish our next small group study. Some of your groups might like to do. Listen to the teaser on the back. What if redirecting a person's forever really is as simple as walking across a room? I like that. Let me share with you one thought out of the heart of the book. Every person alive. Do y'all qualify? Okay. Every person alive has a story. And possibly the greatest realization someone can make is this. My story fits into God's greater story. And that's the greatest story ever told. When people grasp the magnificent truth that the gospel has direct implications for the meaning of their stories, all sorts of light bulbs begin to go off in their mind. I could be found like the lost son. I could be cared for like the good shepherd cares for his sheep. My deepest needs, like the widow's, could actually be met. I can receive abundant life by exhibiting the tiniest amount of faith. It's really true. Anyone can be renewed, transformed, and thrust into abundant life. And as I have said many times before, a significant part of my life's mission is to help people on the front side of the cross to have a vastly different story on the back side of the cross. I like that. That is good stuff right there. I want to spend my days helping people encounter the risen Christ, and in doing so, understand that their story actually makes sense in the context of God's bigger story. Share your story. In our 140-character or less Twitter culture, a precise and powerful testimony is best. Here's a simple flow for sharing your story. In 1 minute or less, tell about your life before you came to Christ. Share your circumstances, your struggles, and questions you had. What path were you on before Jesus? You don't have to give all the gory details, just a few highlights. Number two, second minute or less. Tell how you came to faith. Who was it that shared faith with you? What circumstances surrounded the decision? How did you know this was the right choice? Three, in 1 minute or less, tell how Christ has changed you. What difference has he made? How has life changed after crossing over that line of faith? Four, in 1 minute or less, tell what God is doing in your life right now. Even if you have been a Christian 20 years, God is constantly working in you. So share what is currently going on right now and how you are growing. That's 4 minutes or less. 4 minutes or less. When I shared my story with you at the very beginning, that was 4 minutes and 38 seconds. I'm always a little over time. But 4 minutes or less. You might find it helpful taking a half hour. Sit down. Write this out. 3 to 5 sentences per point. Write it, learn it, and then share it. The last thing you can do, besides sharing your story, is you can share scriptures. Since God's Word has the plan of salvation, there are verses that are helpful. There's lots of ways to do it, lots of tracts that are out there. Maybe the tried and true, but and very brief and concise is what's called the Romans Road. All these verses are found in one book of the Bible. Three questions. One, why do we need salvation? Romans 3:10 says, it is written, there is no one righteous, no, not one. Romans 3:23 says, all have sinned. Who's left out? Nobody. All have sinned and fallen short of God's glory. No one can get to God on his or her own. We all miss the mark of righteousness. Second question, what hope do we have? Romans 5:8 says, God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Out of his great love, God gave the gift of his Son. Are you willing to accept the gift of eternal life? Third question, how can we be saved? Romans 10:9 and 10 says, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord, believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is written, with the heart you believe and are justified, with your mouth you profess your faith, and you are saved. And then Romans 10:13, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Who? Everyone. Anyone who calls will be saved. Believe in our heart. Paul's letter to the Romans contains several other verses, but these three simple steps are enough to lead someone to faith in Christ. There are no magic words. Just a very simple prayer of the heart will do. Here's that simple prayer I opened with at the end of my own testimony. Maybe for the last 20 minutes or so, you've been thinking about that prayer. Maybe you missed that opportunity. Let me offer you a second one this morning. They don't have to be exactly these words. There's not a magic formula to these words, but something similar that says, Heavenly Father, I confess that I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. Please save me. Come into my life and start changing me. I want to spend eternity with you. Thank you for dying on the cross. And thank you, God, Father, for raising your Son from the dead. Thank you for this new life and a risen Savior I now have. In Jesus' name, amen. Regardless of how you choose to deliver the good news of the gospel, by story or by scripture, the most important element is a willingness to share your story. If you are willing and ready, God is able to provide opportunity. Can you recall the last time you shared your faith with someone? In the Christian walk, nothing is more exhilarating than inviting people to discover the difference that God can make in them. You and I must also keep in mind how much God wants to save people. Jesus has been referred to as the hound of heaven. He's looking for you. He is on your trail. The criminal on the cross, minutes before he died, said to Jesus, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." Pretty short prayer, huh? Nothing magical about it, but it was transforming. And Jesus responded, "Today, you'll be with me." I say this often. Don't cut it that close. Minutes before your departure, that's a tough moment. Any reason you can't do it today? Let me close. I once heard a story about a man who attended an art show. He was amazed at this life-size statue of a lion. The detail and the scale were incredible. And the man approached the sculptor who was standing nearby, and he said, "How in the world did you fashion such perfection out of a block of stone?" And the artist smiled and slyly answered, "It's easy. I simply chipped away everything that didn't look like a lion." God's goal is that you and I be transformed into the image of His Son, the Lion of Judah. How does He do it? By chipping away everything that doesn't look like His Son. What does His Son look like? What will you look like if you receive Jesus Christ today? Come back for the next 10 weeks and we'll tell you what the Son looks like and what He'll make you and me to look like. As we believe the truth, practice the truth, we will become like God the Son. Let's pray. Father, thank you for our time today. I pray these were your words and not mine. You make the difference. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer today, tell somebody. I'll be honest, I'd like for you to send me an email and tell me, but it's not required, but we would love to know and say thanks. Have a great day. There are clipboards, front door, back door. Sign up.